Thank you for viewing this post. And you're about to view a whole series of video clips that I'm putting together into one, and I'm going to add commentaries like this one to the different videos before they play about me being Daniel Towsey, being stranded in the city of Dartmouth. I live in Halifax, being stranded all night long in the freezing cold, in the dark, sitting in my electric wheelchair, and you're about to see the nightmare that I went through with Halifax Metro Transit's inspectors, the police, McDonald's restaurants, Accessibus, and a whole series of just extraordinary events that happen, that can happen to anyone that's in an electric wheelchair, in a power wheelchair in Halifax, if they attempt to go out and try to have a life, and discover that if they go out on an old bus, one of the old flyer buses that has the proper tie downs, 4-point tie downs, and then when they try to go back home, if a new bus pulls up, it doesn't have any tie downs to hold the wheelchair down, and it's impossible to go on those buses with a heavy wheelchair, because the wheelchair is going to roll all over the street. If you go to the link below this video series, you're going to see a post that has more information and a lot of previous posts that verify what I'm going to show you and tell you. So please watch this and understand that at this time, when I was trying to get on the first bus, which you're about to see, I was very tired. I've been out for quite a few hours, and there's no accessible bathrooms anywhere, and I had to go to the bathroom, so I was in a lot of pain. And so you're going to hear me talking to the bus driver, but the reason I did this first clip is to show you that it was a new bus. It has a wheelchair ramp. They falsely tell the public that it's safe for wheelchairs, and it's not, because there's no tie down. So if you continue to see this report and look at all my previous reports, you're going to realize that this is a human rights violation. They're violating my right to be able to travel around the city just like everyone else does. And most people in power wheelchairs today don't go anywhere because they encountered the same thing that I just did. But this is a nightmare, because I had no way to get home. So I spent the whole night out on the street until early in the morning. 11 hours later, I took the ferry across to Halifax. And this is pretty horrible. So thank you for watching. And go to wheelchairrights.wordpress.com, as you see on the screen there, to get many more reports and things that I've done over the years, trying to show just how bad things are for disabled people in Halifax and in Nova Scotia. So this is part one, and here we go. So as you can hear in this second clip, I was talking to the driver, telling them why I'm sitting there in the dark after already being there for, like, I don't know, 40 minutes or 30 minutes, and telling him that the bus he's got, I can get on it, but it doesn't take me anywhere close to where I live, which is in Halifax. So it's really a waste of time trying to get on that bus. But I stopped to talk to the driver to let him know why I'm sitting there, and maybe hoping that he would call Metro Transit to help me, and I don't think he did. So that's what this clip is about. Number two. These buses are only running once an hour at this time of the night.
No, I know, but there's on the cordons.
I gotta go all the way up to the commons. I can't be transferring buses and taking chances.
Well, it's up to you, bud.
It's not up to me. It's up to Metro Transit to put some tie downs on these buses so that people in wheelchairs can get around. What's the ramp on here for? You know how dangerous it is to have a 600-pound, 800-pound wheelchair rolling around on there on casters?
I know, buddy. Well, you know, for your concerns, unfortunately, I gotta go.
So you can't take me home. I'm sitting out here in the dark. If something happens to me because somebody mugs me, who's going to be blamed? Because you guys at Metro Transit can't provide safe buses for wheelchairs. that's what it's like to live in Halifax. Every single brand new bus they've been buying for the last 5, 6, 8 years, whatever it is, don't have any straps. They've got the ramps, they've got the space for the wheelchairs, and they don't have any straps to hold my wheelchair down. So this is what happens when you get stranded. It's late at night, buses are only running once an hour. This is in Halifax, I should say Dartmouth, Nova Scotia, which is the same as Halifax. You go to wheelchairrights.wordpress.com and see many more reports about what goes on in Halifax. It's not just the Nova buses, it's all the buses. Even the new Flyer buses don't have any straps to hold my wheelchair down. The only strap they have is the one that they put around your waist and your neck. And as soon as the bus stops or turns or does anything. Anyway, you can read my other reports about how these buses cannot carry wheelchairs. So, I've been waiting here for half an hour, and that 61, which just came here, is the only bus that runs to Halifax, and they only run once an hour. It is now, let's see, what time is it? It's 9:20. Next one comes at 10:30, and then another one maybe at 11:30, and then that's it. I would be stranded here for the night. All because Halifax Metro Transit doesn't want to put straps on the buses to hold the wheelchairs down. These people have got to be insane. These wheelchairs are really heavy and they're sitting on casters. There's no brakes on wheelchairs. And if you read my other reports, you'll understand why I can't go on a bus where they want me to sit backwards, facing backwards. The backrest on my chair isn't made to hold the weight of my chair when the bus puts its brakes on. It's absolutely insane and criminally negligent to be endangering people's lives. And so everybody in wheelchairs in this town goes through this. They go somewhere and they often can't get home because new bus after new bus pulls up and then you're stranded there, just like it's happening right now. But try being in a wheelchair and having to live like this. It's a modern world. We have all these expensive buses and stupid assholes don't want to put the force tie down straps that are necessary to hold a wheelchair from moving around while they're driving. So again, go to wheelchairrights.wordpress.com to get more reports. This is a 59 bus that's pulling up, and it's an old one. So, before you get out of your seat, first of all, do you have any hooks on this bus? Metal hooks?
Yeah.
Okay. The other problem I have is this. Hold on. I'm actually on the phone with the police right now, okay? The 61 is the one I need to get home, which only takes me close to where I live. I've only got enough battery power to go from the Oxford Theater all the way down Roby to Quinpool and Roby. No other bus can get me home. I can't be getting on and off buses and going, and I don't want to sit here for an hour.
Okay, you want this bus?
I don't want to sit here for an hour. I don't
want
to sit at the... Anyway, I'm going to be parked in the middle of the street in a minute, getting the cops to come over here. You guys need to call Accessibus. They need to get Accessibus over here. That's no safer than sitting here. And it's still going to be how long before the 61 comes?
I'm running a 59.
I know, 61 is the only one that can get me home. This one only goes to where? To a bridge terminal? Right. Then I'd still have to sit there and wait for the 61, and they're probably going to pull up another new one. All the new buses don't have tie downs.
They have what's required.
It's not required.
That's all they give us.
You have to have four tie downs to hold these 600, 800 pound wheelchairs.
Listen, we don't make the buses.
Nobody cares anymore.
What do you want me to do? I just drove the bus.
Don't give me excuses. Those buses aren't safe. You shouldn't be allowing.
I don't manufacture buses.
When you drive a new bus that doesn't have tie downs, don't let wheelchairs on. So now this is part two. Now you know what I go through. And, I'm sitting on my cell phone, and I guess I'm on hold because they said, oh, I'll put 911 on, and they never came on the phone. So I wonder how this evening's gonna turn out. Part two. In part three, I was talking on the phone with the police and the dispatch and trying to get them to help me, which they wouldn't do. So they transferred me over to Metro Transit. Just keep listening to the radio and you're going to see that Metro Transit really didn't care that I was standing on the street. And so my nightmare just continued and continued. 11 hours I sat out there Wait until you see the rest of this video when you see me sitting at a gas station and somebody had to go to my house to get my charger to charge my wheelchair up because I'd been out too long. Freezing cold, sitting in my wheelchair on a lonely street by myself. Thank you very much, Halifax Transit and everybody else for not caring except for that one police officer that went to my home and got my charger. This is, I don't know, this is Coatfoot Park number 4. Part 3. They're transferring me to Metro Transit on the phone, as you can see. Pretty bad when I can't go anywhere in this town because the buses can't transport me back home. I've only got so much battery power left, so I know I can't go that far. So the police non-emergency dispatch transfers me over to Accessa Bus by telephone, and I told them, well, all I'm going to get is an answering machine, and an Accessa Bus recording comes on and says that they're closed. So that's how Metro Transit treats people that are disabled in wheelchairs. They leave them stranded and endanger their lives, and the people don't realize that when you can't be safely travel on public transportation in your wheelchair, when the buses are supposed to be able to secure your wheelchair and supposed to be doing it safely, this is what happens. I get stranded in my, I have no life in this town. I cannot travel on buses because every time I attempt to go somewhere, I often get stranded like this. This is how bad it really is. So eventually I'm going to have to do something drastic, like park my ass in the middle of that street until the police show up and call up Accessa Bus and get me home. Or I have to wait another 40 minutes for the next 61 bus to show up and hope that it's an older one that has the 4 tie downs with hooks on it. And I'm liable to get stranded out here. But in the meantime, while I'm sitting here by myself on a city street in the dark, it's pretty dangerous to be sitting here in a wheelchair because it was still light out when I was trying to get on that bus. I didn't want to be out here after dark. So this is part number 3, I think it is. I'm just going to keep doing reports on this, short ones, and I'm going to put them all together. And then you're going to see what it's like to be stranded in Metro Transit, endangering lives of people in wheelchairs because they don't provide buses that are safe to secure the wheelchairs down. So, this is probably part number 3. Thank you. So, back on the phone I go. Was I just talking to you? Okay. I'm trying to get home, and I'm on Portland Street, and all the buses that are coming up can't get me home. And the reason why the bus that came was a 61, and it doesn't have any tie-downs. Now there's a 68 here, but none of these buses are going to Halifax. Just a second, please. You've got metal hooks? Do you have metal hooks on this bus to hold my chair down?
Yeah.
You do? Anyway, I'm going to get on this bus, but that's only going to take me to the bus terminal. This 61 that came over here was one of the new buses, and they have to have the 4 tie downs to hold my chair down, and didn't have any tie downs. So I couldn't travel on that new bus, and that's what I keep telling Metro Transit. You've got to equip the buses with the secure tie downs, and they don't have any. No, I'm talking to the bus driver. Okay, I'm gonna get off the phone. I'm only gonna get to the bus terminal. Thank you. So, this is one of the old buses that has the tie downs, but that's only gonna get me a part ways home. In this video clip I'm gonna upload to YouTube separately, if you go below this video that you're going to see the link to the full article of the events that happened on this night where I got stranded on the street for 11 hours, sitting in my wheelchair all night long. So after I'd been stranded for a few hours, I was really getting tired and I was in a lot of pain. I had to go to the bathroom, but I couldn't. There was no place to go. And I get this nasty driver. I get partly in on the bus and I look and I realize there's people sitting in the way and I can't get by. So I stop and I said to him, well, I can't go any further because I'm going to hit their legs. And normally the drivers know that the people have to get up on. This is a smaller bus than other ones, not as wide. So I get on the bus and finally the bus driver starts having a really stupid, nasty attitude. And I realize, oh, I've got a problem, so I better turn on my camera. And so the people that finally, voluntarily moved out of the way, but the driver didn't lift up that seat to move it out of my way. And he was standing a little too close and trying to spin my wheelchair around so I can back into the space on the right in that tight area. And luckily I can move my feet, so I was able to lift my, I'm able to lift up my foot plate, you know, my foot plate out of the way. But even so, it was too tight. And I even told the driver that I'm not going to have room to turn around because he didn't lift up the seat out of the way for me. And he was in my way. I couldn't move forward far enough to make that, to make my turn. So as you see in the video, I attempted to turn and I hit my knees against the seat. So I stopped and I looked to the left and I realized I can't turn any further because there's no room because I'm up against the wheel well. I had to move forward a little bit, so I turned back and I had to move forward a little bit, and then the bus driver starts saying I tried to kill him and hit him with my wheelchair. That guy's completely nuts. And I had enough and I started screaming at him because he was standing in my way. And what I was trying to do after I had told him, when I got on the bus and he refused to be cooperative and he was giving me a hassle, I told him I want to get off this bus. I don't want to be on your bus. So I told him I still got to get in the bus and turn around so I can get out of this bus. And he sits there twice. He blurted out loud that I tried to run him over with my wheelchair, and I point the camera right at him. I said, what? This is insane. And then the guy says that he wanted to make sure that he was going to charge me for attempting to kill him with my wheelchair by running him over. So now you see what I put up with at Halifax Metro Transit. The buses have cameras. And if you ever get abused by a driver on a public transit bus, they're not ever going to let you have those video clips off that bus. And this bus that I was on here, it wasn't one that was going to get me home. It was only going to get me down to the bus terminal where I might have been able to get a different bus. But if I had done this, taken that bus and went to the bus terminal, I would have ended up going to another bus terminal in Halifax. I would have had to transfer four times, and it would have taken me hours and hours and hours to try to get home. That's if. The buses that pulled in at the bus terminal were wheelchair accessible buses that had the tie down so I could get to Halifax. Well, I got off his bus and the nightmare continued. So please keep watching the series and make sure you go to the link below so you can get the whole series of me spending 11 hours on the street all night long, stranded in my wheelchair because of people like this bus driver and Halifax Metro Transit. Thank you for viewing. So I just told you that I haven't got room to spin around. I'm recording you now, okay? I said I don't have, okay, so now I need to get off the bus, okay? And I can't back off the ramp going backwards. I still have to turn around and get off this bus. So I have to go in there to turn around. They're going to be in the way. This chair is huge. When I spin around, I'm going to hit their feet.
Yeah, well, if you had asked...
I don't want to hear anything from you. I want to get off your bus, okay? You're all a bunch of ignorant, stupid drivers that don't listen to anybody. I don't like being stranded on the street because Metro Transit has new buses and none of them have tie downs.
I'm a bus driver. I don't buy
Nobody cares. I already know that.
And nobody cares what you've got to say.
That's right. Nobody cares about anybody today. Okay? May as well get your ugly face on my camera. See how much room I need to turn around? Do you see it? You don't care. You're
get
a driver?
Off the bus.
You're a driver? Wow. If you weren't standing there, I would have had room to spin around so I could turn around in this bus.
You ram that chair into me and you'll be in for an assault.
Ram the chair into you? I'm ramming the chair into you? I'm ramming the chair into you? Thank you. Leave me alone. Go away. Go sit in your seat and get out of my face. Bunch of ignorant, stupid drivers. Get out of my way so I can get off your dumb bus. Metro Transit's got a whole bunch of assholes.
Just keep on going.
You don't like truth, eh?
No, I don't like your mouth.
Oh, well, what do you think happens when I get stranded on the sidewalk because all your new buses don't have tie downs?
I'm not driving a new bus.
That's, you don't care anyway. You don't care about anything. You got cameras up there recording me.
Are you hearing this foolishness?
Foolishness, listen to him.
I have a very irate.
Very irate. Yeah, go ahead.
A very irate person in a wheelchair that is just freaking out here. He won't get off the bus. He won't get on the bus. He almost hit me with the chair twice now.
You hear that? Did you hear that, guys? He says I tried to hit him with my chair.
I want him charged if I can.
You're an idiot, man. You're a really stupid goofball. You know that? You think because I'm in a wheelchair that you can abuse me?
Yeah, I'm right here. Well, actually, he just managed to roll himself off the bus. But he didn't stop waiting for the next door. My driver was there crossing.
Anyway, you people on the bus, now you know what people in wheelchairs have to deal with. This isn't even my bus. I want the 61 to get home.
Would you please move away?
Why don't you shut up, asshole? Go get a different job. So I guess maybe this is part 6. I got the police to pull over. There's that guy, and the only thing that happened on this bus, dude, I don't want to hear anything from you. And I said I can't spin around because there's no room for me to turn. And he wouldn't ask the people to leave. Look, he's taken off. He's taken off because he can't handle dealing with the police.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. It is a nightmare living in this town and being in a wheelchair. The 61 is the only bus that can get me home all the way to Quinpool and Robie. And that doesn't even go there. And I've got enough battery power to go from Roxford down Ruby, down Quinpool to Ruby. I came down here on a 61. The 61's only run once an hour. The 61 that pulls up is a new one that has no tie downs to hold my wheelchair, so I can't travel on those buses because my wheelchair will choke me. It'll slide. It's impossible. It has to be secured. Metro Transit has known about this for a few years now. They don't care. So every bus that comes here isn't taking me home, and it would take me only to the bus terminal. And then I would have to transfer again. So there's no point in me going to the bus terminal because the only bus that goes to Halifax that can take me home is the 61. I called Metro Transit on the phone. That you get an answering machine. Access the bus, you get an answering machine. I get on that bus, and that stupid driver had a really nasty attitude. It's a narrow bus. And I've been on buses enough times to know how to drive my wheelchair in and out of buses. So when you pull into that bus, if there's two people sitting on this side, I can't spin around to back into the space. No room. So he got me pissed off because when I went in, I said, well, I can't spin here. There's no room because the people are in the way. And he starts with his, I was recording it on my camera. I have to. I can't get on buses anymore without recording what they're doing because this is really bad. So they wouldn't move because he didn't want, and he was standing in the way. So they got up on their own. So when they got up, the seat hadn't been lifted, and just even without the seat being lifted, when I tried to spin around, I actually can move my legs, so I'm lucky because I can lift up my foot pedals. If I couldn't lift up my foot pedals, I wouldn't be able to even get onto most of the buses. They're not big enough. So I'm trying to spin around. He's sitting there telling me off, and he's really rude and ignorant. And I said, man, this is what I have to go through all the time with Metro Transit. You guys are building million-dollar buses that don't have any straps to hold wheelchairs. You can't put a strap around someone's neck and then leave the chair loose on the ground sitting on casters. Soon as they move, the wheelchair is going to roll. There's not anybody you'll ever meet in this town that has a wheelchair that's powered that is driving around on any of those new buses. It is impossible. So Metro Transit doesn't care. And I told them, you're leaving me stranded out here in the dark by myself in a wheelchair. And I have no guarantee I'm even going to get home because the 61 is the one that I need to get home. These can't take me home. Yeah, but they can only take me to the bus terminal. I need to go to Halifax. So the 61 is the one that I have to take home. I don't like being stuck out here in the dark. It was light out when I was trying to get on that bus.
Right.
So Metro Transit, the dispatch transferred me over to Metro Transit, and I ended up getting access to bus, but access to bus isn't answering their phones at this time.
Right.
They do have people, the driver is
I'm going to stop you for a minute there,
sure.
Sir. I got to get some information from you. And
then
we're going to discuss what it is you need or would like.
I need to get home.
I can't take you home, sir.
Oh, I know that. No. It doesn't even fit the taxi. It doesn't fit in anything.
So, what's your name, sir?
Daniel.
Daniel, what's your last name, Daniel?
Towsey.
Well, I'm sorry?
Towsey.
How do you spell that, please?
Towsey. And then In this next long clip, you're going to hear me first talking to the police who called in supervisors from Halifax Metro Transit. And our discussion was pretty interesting. There's some key points that were made. One is that Metro Transit supervisors confirmed that the new buses cannot secure wheelchairs and that the Metro Transit was ordered to retrofit all the buses. And I told them, yeah, that was back in January. Nothing's been done. And the other thing that they noticed, is that the street where the bus stop where I was standing here, across the street, the 61 goes up, does a big loop around Preston and the whole area like that, and comes back down. And the bus that was going by across the street was a 61, an old bus that I could get home on. And I got pretty suspicious when I was sitting on that street and every other bus that came back down the 61 was a new bus. But the ones going up were old buses. And right away I knew something's up, something's not right. And that's why I realized I must be getting set up again, because for them to call up the bus drivers and tell them, change your number on your bus, it only takes a second. They can do it just for that bus stop, drive down the road and change the number back. It's all computer. It's all easy to do. And I'm thinking that Metro Transit deliberately sent these new buses knowing I couldn't get home. And the reason why I'm saying that is because when I went to McDonald's later, as you're going to see in the videos, and I was talking on the inside and it was complications. But anyway, I decided to go outside to talk because I was talking to people and I talked pretty loud. I go outside and there's four police cars that were sitting out there. And there was no problem while I was in McDonald's. They didn't ask me to leave. I just went outside. And I told McDonald's that I'll be outside if you, because they were trying to call excessive bus again because I couldn't get on the excessive bus that came. So I talked to those police at that location now for quite a while. And I'll make a note of this later in a further video of what happened at McDonald's. So if you watch this clip here, number 8, you will hear me talking to the inspectors and describing to them the scenario or the situation that I'm in, and you'll hear their answers. And you know, everybody's answers, everybody I talked to that night, we were all doing the same thing. Nobody was going to help. And if you ask me, I don't know, I think they were hoping that I would stay in that dark spot. But I had enough power to get all the way up to the McDonald's restaurant, which is well lit and there's a lot of people there. Because when those 6 police cars showed up, one of the officers, a black guy, was pretty vicious, pretty demanding and trying to cause a scene. Other police officers saying, can you get out of that chair? And one said, I'm not touching him since his back is broken. So to me, if I wasn't in a wheelchair, those cops would have beat the shit out of me. That's about all the only intention they had. That's what my impression I got. But it didn't happen because I was, belted into a wheelchair and they couldn't get me out anyway. And they didn't want to be looking like the aggressors. And plus, they didn't really want to do anything with all the cars that kept driving through the drive-thru. So the location for me was pretty safe. And that's why I went there. Because in this day and age, everybody knows you can't trust anyone. After the police shot that young man on the TTC public transit system in Toronto, and that young man that was just having a bad day and he wasn't bothering anybody, there was nobody on the thing. So 9 shots, and then they tasered him and shot him again, whatever it was. Nature, he was dead. So talking to police in my condition or my situation, I try to trust them, but there's subversives up above the police that give orders. And since our governments are no longer corporations, we're in a lot of trouble. Since our governments are no longer common law governments and now have corporate interests that they serve, and they don't care about the rights of the individual. And everything you hear about your rights is all fake because it's not enforced by anything. As you can see, I have the right to travel on public transit, and it has to, by law, it has to be safe equipment that can secure my wheelchair. So please listen to this long report here, this part here, and go down to the link underneath the video here to see the whole report and get all the video clips that I did that night until I got home 11 hours later, being stranded in the dark on a cold night on a street sitting in my wheelchair. Thank you for viewing. This is Daniel Towsey from wheelchairrights.wordpress.com reporting.
So can I call a Metro Transit supervisor here to speak?
Well, yeah, because they got to leave me stuck out here in the dark on a street like this, because this is not safe for me at all. I didn't want to be out here in the dark.
West 3 Alpha, primary east. Would we be able to give Metro Transit a call, please? Have one of their supervisors come by to the bus stop at Portland and Lakefront. A gentleman by the name of Daniel Towson,
T-O-W-S-E.
Yeah, I can't get home because the bus that came over doesn't have any tie downs. The 61 goes to Halifax.
In relation to wheelchair.
So I got stuck. No, I can't. He doesn't have tie downs.
I know you're stuck.
You need four tie downs on those, but they don't have any. Thanks, Scott. That's the kind of bus that came up. One of the new ones. They don't have any tie downs to secure the wheelchair. None. That should be illegal. They want the wheelchair to back up and rest against that post. The backrests are not designed to hold the weight of these chairs when the bus is braking, right? Like when they manufacture these, they put four metal hoops on them. All over the world, they have to do this because these chairs are really heavy, and those are transport hooks. So then when the chair is being transported, it has to be secured by four tie-downs. Those buses shouldn't be allowed to pick up any wheelchairs, because if someone gets on there not knowing and they turn, the wheelchair is going to move and that strap across their neck is going to kill them. It is really, really dangerous. I mean, I didn't think they were running new buses on this route, so I came up here.
Yeah.
And I haven't been up here in a year now.
Oh, really?
I used to live in this neighborhood. I had to move away because I couldn't travel on buses. This is also crazy. And then some of these drivers just have such bad attitudes, and all I'm doing is just speaking up for my rights. I want to be able to travel safely on the buses, and Metro Transit isn't providing safe buses for wheelchairs. And I can't endanger my life on those new buses. This is crazy. You know, I get so depressed every day realizing I can't make appointments with friends. I can't go anywhere anymore. I've been stranded like this before, sometimes in rainstorms and everything. I go somewhere and I do my shopping, and then I get stuck there sometimes for 3 hours because every bus that comes up is a new one that doesn't have any tie downs. That's got, man, someone, this is a civilized society we live in. Someone's got to fix this problem. I'm not the only person in a wheelchair that's being stranded everywhere. Everybody that I know that are friends of mine in wheelchairs no longer go anywhere because they have no guarantee they're going to get home. Just like happened here. Oh, I was so depressed when I saw that new bus pull up, and I thought, oh no, they run once an hour and I'm going to be stuck out here in the dark. And I don't want to get mugged out of here. I had no plan to be out here in the dark, because if I got on that bus, I would have been home safe.
Yeah, I know for sure.
And then one driver said, well, I can take you to the bus terminal. What am I going to do there? What bus is going to take me to my neighborhood? Only the 61. So what's the point of getting on there and getting off here when I have to wait for the 61? It's the only bus that can get me home. So I'm not going to transfer to five different buses to try to get home.
That's the bus that just came to pick you up?
That's an old bus. That one has the tie downs. But he's got to go a long ways around. It's a huge route. He's not going to be back here for at least another half hour. Maybe longer, because he's got to go all the way up to Preston, all the way around. And so this is the biggest route in HRM. That's actually the 14. Man, holy jeez. The guy told me that the round route on that bus is 4 hours. 4 hours. It's the biggest route in the HRM.
Send one supervisor, they send.
Well, everybody that works for Metro Transit is aware of my situation, because I'm not the only one, but I'm speaking up because I want my life. And the problem is that the people at Metro Transit that run the thing, well, what they're doing is criminal negligence, because they're knowingly endangering lives of people in wheelchairs. Because I know of two people that were sitting in one of those buses and the chair went sideways, because they always do, because they're sitting on casters. There's no brakes on casters. The chair went over, flipped over, and it killed two people on those buses. They felt the chair squashed them. I'm not taking that chance.
How are you doing,
guys?
Good, how are you? This is Mr.
Towson.
Yes, sir. We met before?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So I'm going to leave you in their capable hands, Mr.
Towson. Yeah, I'll try to resolve this. Great. If you go away, I can see you, because I can't throw my head that far.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. I'm upset right now because it's dark out, and I had no intention of be sitting on this street in the dark.
Okay.
I used to live in this neighborhood. I'd love to be able to come more often here, but I don't. So last time I was here was a year ago, and that lake is my favorite. I used to sit there, relax, and when I'm wound up, and I had a nice, peaceful time. So I'm sitting there. I'm realizing it's getting dark, and I'm looking, and I figured, okay, so I waited for half an hour, the 61 comes up, and it's a new bus. And there's no way in the world that I can travel on any new buses that don't have tie downs. This chair is almost 800 pounds. It's on sitting on casters. And it's not designed to face backwards and have the weight, because if the weight pushes against my backrest, the backrest isn't designed to hold the weight of this chair. So if he puts the brakes on, my backrest is gonna bend, and I've got a steel frame on mine. All the other chairs are plastic backrests. I have a broken back. The other problem is that I can't wear the shoulder straps, because I have a waiver for that, because my whole rib cage is broken. So I can't even wear that to begin with.
Do you have the waiver on you?
Yeah, I do. I've always had a waiver for that. Let's see if I can find it. So, you know, the thing is that all manufacturers, it's probably in here, yeah. All manufacturers put four metal, they're called transport loops. They're metal hoops that are attached to the wheelchairs. All wheelchairs have that because they need to be hooked down to be transported safely. That's done like that worldwide. So why is Metro Transit not providing the hooks to secure the wheelchair? There. So I've had that ever since my injury, because I told them, I said, I can't have straps across my chest because most of my ribs, I was run over by a car, everything's broken. That's why I can stand, but I can't walk anywhere because everything moves, my spine's broken. It's a miracle I'm even alive. So, and you know, to keep from getting depressed, I've got to be able to get out of my home. I can't stay stuck at home staring at a computer all day long. And that's what I spend most of my life doing now, because friends want to see me. People said, hey, can you come to this festival, do this? I can't do anything anymore, because I never know if I'm going to get home, like happened tonight. This has happened to me before. One time it was cold weather, it was snowing outside, and I got stuck there. Another time it was a big rainstorm, and I couldn't get home. It took me 3 hours in the rain.
Okay.
Where do you live at?
Quinpool and Roby. So yeah. The 61 takes me to Oxford and Roby, and I have just enough power. See my light's down to 2? As soon as it goes down, I've got maybe 20 minutes at the maximum, half an hour driving. That's it. Then the battery goes dead. So I know right now when I'm looking at that, because I planned it all out, I'm sitting here, that bus will take me where I have enough power to get home, and I'm all set. I told the guy, I can't sit here in the dark for an hour, man. This isn't safe for me at all, sitting here like this. And I don't know if the next bus is going to come up, is going to be accessible for me or not. But what happened is I talked to the police, I talked to different people, I'm not getting anywhere, nothing is resolved. The last driver that was just here, the last bus that stopped, I think it was 59 or something like that. Mm-hmm. What a stupid attitude he had, eh? And you know what? What I've decided to do from now on, whenever I have a problem with access to bus, Metro Transit, I just record it with my camera. I have to. It's on my website. There's a record of, and it's not me. People like this guy here that was just here.
What happened?
The guy's got to be some really stupid human being.
Okay, but you need to explain to me.
Yeah, explain to you. I have it on camera, because as soon as he started, I realized, oh, I better turn my camera on, because this guy's going to cause me trouble, and the camera saves me, because without my camera, I can't prove what he's doing.
Okay.
So when I got on that bus, I have to actually lift this up. If I couldn't lift up my foot pedals, I wouldn't even be able to fit on those buses, because I can't get around the corner. Because this is a huge chair, and I'm a tall person. That's why the chair is big. So, like I said, I've done this enough times. I do know how to get on and off the buses. For me to get on and off those flyer buses, I have to go back and forth to risk feet fit around the corner just to get out past the wheel well. But I can get on easier than I can get off. So I get on, and there's two people sitting there in the seat, and it wasn't flipped up. And he's standing in the middle of the aisleway, so I come in part ways. And before I continue going in, I said, well, I won't be able to spin around because the people are in the way. It's impossible.
Right.
No room. Okay. And he looks at me really stupid, doesn't care. And he starts, like, it's on the recording. His attitude is really bad. The people that were sitting there listened to me and realized that what I was saying. So they voluntarily, I didn't ask him, he didn't ask them, but he didn't want them to move. He was blocking everybody, blocking me and them. So they actually had got up, but he didn't flip the seat up for me. Okay, to get it out of the way.
Okay.
So even when I was recording this on my camera, even while I was turning it, my knees scraped against the seat because that's how narrow the bus is.
Right.
So, you know, his attitude was bad, and I'm just not in the mood because I don't like being stranded like this. Believe me, the world is not a safe place, okay? Being in a wheelchair, I can't defend myself against anything.
So with that happening, you just chose to get off the bus?
Oh, yeah. As soon as I realized he didn't want to help me or be cooperative, I wasn't rude to him until when I said to him, I won't have room to turn around.
Okay.
And he didn't care. Stood there with his attitude, and he started up on me. I went, oh, no. That's when I said, no, I'm not putting up with this. So I turned on my camera. I said, I'm going to record this. You know what he said to me? Because he didn't flip the seat up, and because he was standing in my way, I had even less room to spin around. So I had to spin around, but I had to do it. When I spun around, I hit the seat. So I'm stopped. He's in my way. And what I had to do is go back facing him, move up a little bit so I could have room to try to turn around again. And he sits there and says that I tried to hit him with my chair. I mean, I looked at him. I said, man, you've got to be out of your mind. And I have it on camera, right? I didn't go anywhere near him. But as soon as, oh, his attitude, that's why I'm so upset. You know what? I'm not in a wheelchair and disabled to put up with abuse from people. I don't do it to other people. But in the past, I wasn't recording anything on my camera, and these guys would get away with lying and twisting things around. You have cameras on your buses, but do you think you guys ever provide me the film for my defense? Never. That'll never happen. So I realized, well, you're going to record me. I've even got one here if I have to. I can turn that one on, and it's got sound. So if you look at those buses and you realize the ones that flip up, okay, look at how wide my chair is this way. So from the back wall where the foot seat is up to my knees, I covered the whole aisle. The other seat has to be flipped up. I can't turn around on that bus, not enough room. So I tried it, but let me tell you, man, if I hit my legs or my feet on something with this chair is heavy and the motors are very powerful. I can end up with a broken leg.
Where are you going?
61, I need to get home, and it's got to have hooks on it. Quinpool and Rollby is where I live.
I was going to say he was going to the bridge, you would have flagged him.
But no, all of them are useless to me. I still need the 61 to get home. Nothing at the bridge is going to get me anywhere close to my home. So I can't do that because I won't have enough battery power, and I don't want to be running through downtown. See, Quinpool is well lit up, so it's safe for me to go down that street. A lot of these streets, it's not safe for me to go anywhere. I don't want to be mugged.
Now, just to go back to that paper, you freely show that to them, right?
Well, anytime, yeah, they know, yeah, I've always had this. But that's not the issue. The new buses, this isn't even the problem. Even without that, it doesn't make any difference. They can't secure the wheelchair because they put a strap here and one around your waist. If the wheelchair moves, the weight of the wheelchair is going to crush the person sitting in the chair. Well, me, I can't do that, not with my spine and ribs broken. And other people that know me, my breathing is always very difficult. When you hear me speaking aggressive, it's because I have to breathe aggressive. I use my voice to regulate my rib cage doesn't move. Okay, good. I'm glad. At least I got a couple of people that aren't going to give me any trouble. Oh, I hate this. I don't want to have any more problems in my life. I'm talking to people and I say, I've got to move out of Halifax. I've got to find some way to get some civilized city because I want a life. I can't even go to trails and parks like I did. I can't go anywhere anymore. I never know if I'm going to get home. I mean, there's no need for that. Those buses cost a fortune. They've got the wheelchair ramps. You need to provide the tie-downs to hold my chair. Come on, who's going to wake up? Who's going to do this? Who's going to fix this problem? You're endangering every person's life that's in a wheelchair. All the friends I have in electric wheelchairs do not travel on Metro Transit anymore. They gave up. You have no freedom anymore.
When's the next one coming?
He's coming right now.
And we know
where
the bus is.
I want to get the bus on the queue.
That last guy that was here, if you pull the recording, okay.
We know who it is.
Yeah, well, please, because I didn't say a word to him. I was already very upset because three buses and all this, and I was talking on the phone, and I'm upset because I'm sitting here in the dark. It was light out when that bus came when I wanted to get on.
Now, it's also important, though, that if you want to file a complaint.
No, it's okay. I know what? My life is complicated enough. It won't make any difference. I don't want to get involved more. I've already written reports for Metro Transit. They were aware of this 4 years ago. It's on my website. The government, everybody knows about it, and nobody cares. Nobody cares. Wow. The public, when they find out that I'm supposed to have the same rights as everyone else, the right to travel is guaranteed under our Constitution. And I'm being deprived of that because Metro Transit isn't providing the tie downs that are necessary, and there's not a manufacturer in the world that isn't going to say to you that if you're going to have this chair on a moving vehicle, whether there's a passenger in it or not, you have to use the four tie downs to secure it. That's worldwide, even without a passenger in a chair.
I'm not going to comment on that too much tonight.
It's a good thing I hardly ever take buses anymore, because if I was to take buses every day and go through this, I'd be calling you guys every day, because this is what happened to me every day. You know, you're getting more and more new buses, and the old ones are being retired, and eventually you won't have any buses that'll have any tie-downs on them.
Go ahead.
There's another type of bus. There's two older flyer buses, right? But now there's even newer ones. But back then we used to say the newer or little flyer buses, okay? So the newer of the two versions. The older ones, they have the belt and buckle straps, okay? And then they tell people in wheelchairs, you got to have straps on your chair.
What's
doesn't work on my chair because the size of my chair with the straps on it, when they put their buckles on, they can't even tighten the straps. They're like they can't even, like their straps are too long for my chair.
Well, they are.
No, the ones without the hooks.
Yeah, I know, but they are going through all the buses and putting hooks on all the buses.
That's not, I don't see any signs of that. All the new buses don't have them.
I heard that
was supposed to be done last January, and I never saw one bus that was retrofitted, not one. All these new million-dollar buses that are flying around, all the articulated buses, all of them, every single one of them doesn't have any tie-downs. You know? I told the police, this is getting so desperate, and one of these days I'm going to park my ass in right in the middle of the street and make a big scene because someone's got to pay attention. What do I have to do? Start yelling and screaming for my rights? I don't want to be stuck out here in the dark. This neighborhood is okay, but it does have problems. It won't take me home. So yeah, I can't get home. Sorry, guys. I mean, I know you guys are getting paid for this, but I'd rather not be going through any of this. I'd rather just live my life like everyone else.
But what I'd like to explain to you is the fact that you were on a bus. The last one that you were on. Although the operator you were saying was rude to you.
Yeah.
You could have still had him strap you in and everything.
No,
and
I couldn't even. The seat was never lifted up for me, the one on the left. Well, people got out of the way, but he never. Then when I tried to maneuver to make room, he said I tried to hit him with my chair. Okay. That guy's out of his mind.
Okay.
Guy's completely out of his mind. I told him I want to get off here. As soon as his attitude started, as soon as he did that, when I was trying to get in, as soon as I realized that he had an attitude and he didn't want to help me at all to be able to get on the bus, I said, I want to get off the bus.
Okay.
And I told him I still can't get off the bus because I can't turn around because they're in the way. There's no room for me to turn, right?
Okay.
So they got up then. Then I get in and he still never lifted up the seat. I hit my legs against it, so I had to try again to try to turn around. And then he wouldn't get out of my way. He was standing too close to me.
Okay.
Oh, my God, man. Know what? I didn't do anything for him to treat me like that. That guy really made my night much worse than what it is.
So the problem we have now is the next 61 that's coming through.
It's going to be the same thing.
It's a brand new bus.
Won't take me home.
So we're going to have to see what we can do.
All right. But you know what, though? I don't know when they're going to retrofit all the new buses, but I hope they do it soon because I've been not taking buses now for almost 3 years. You know? I don't have Metro Transit servicing me at my home with accessible bus. They won't provide me accessible bus at my building because they know I wrote reports for the government about the issues of Metro Transit, right? So the dispatchers are being real assholes to me on the phone. They won't come to my building. They won't pick me up. I'm on the list for accessible bus, and they're denying me accessible bus service completely, 100%.
Okay.
That's bad.
Okay.
And there's no need for that. I've never had a problem with accessible bus, so why aren't they providing me that? You know what? You know, if there was a criminal investigator investigating what they've been doing to me, some of the people that are making these decisions, so, like that bus driver's attitude, why does he have an attitude towards me? Like, why should he even know me?
I don't know, but why should he even know me? I don't know.
I was on the phone with the police when he pulled up, and I hung up from the police, and I said, okay, I'll see if I can get, but I said to him.
Why did you originally call the police?
Because I was stranded in the dark, and I couldn't get home, and I had no guarantee I was getting home. And the bus driver, he didn't call you guys when I asked him to, so.
From the new one.
Yeah, he didn't call you, so.
Okay.
So I'm looking at all these buses coming up, and none of them are taking me anywhere close to my house. And I thought, what's the point? Because the 61, what's the point of me going to the bridge just to hop on the 61? Why bother? I may as well catch it here. It's the same thing,
okay.
Right? So.
Okay.
And that's why I started getting worried, because I'm thinking, well, am I going to get home? You know, so one of the drivers that stopped, I asked him, can you call you guys to tell me if I can get home?
Right.
And nobody was helping me, so I called the police.
Okay.
Nobody was helping me. And then the police said, well, there's not much we can do. I said, well, if the police aren't going to help me and Metro Transit isn't going to help me to get home, I'm going to park myself in the middle of the street and make a big scene. Otherwise, I'm not getting home. And the only reason why you're here is because I flagged down a policeman.
No, the original call did come from the second bus, the Route 68.
Oh, so okay, good, because the police were here and I was talking to them, and they called you guys to.
We were already on our way when we were notified by our communications.
That's why you were so fast.
Well, no, the second bus, the Route 68, that you had got.
You don't mind if I light a cigarette, do you? Because I've been sitting here for quite a while.
No, that's fine. Go right ahead.
Okay. You know, the other day on the waterfront, the police were talking to me, and I told them, I described to them, I don't tell people my injuries, but. They now know that I talk loud because at the rate I'm talking right now is when I can maintain my air. But if I get upset and I speak too fast, then I've got a really big problem breathing.
Okay.
all this got crushed by a car, and believe me, I'm in horrific pain all day long. Every movement, even talking, the ribs are trying to move. I live with so much pain, and the only way I deal with that pain is not to think about it, try to distract my mind, do something else, and just try to, like sitting over here and watching the ducks today, I had to do it. I had to relax. And an ending like this is not, please, not good.
Well, it's not over yet. We're seeing what we can do, but like I said, the next bus is due to come in. It's 1168, so that's one of the newer buses.
It can't take me home. So if I had gone down to the bridge, I would have been stuck there anyway. That's no good to me. None of those buses can take me home. Oh my goodness, that means now I can never come back to Dartmouth because I can't take this chance of ever being stranded again. This is crazy. I only go on a bus like once or twice a month now because of these problems. And it's happening every time I go out somewhere. I said, what's the point? I have no transportation. My wheelchair gets worn out. These guys are freaking out. I can't keep tires on my chair. And I told them the only life I have is to roll around on the sidewalks. I can't go anywhere on any vehicle. The private taxis, their roofs are too low. I'm too tall. I don't fit on them, right? The only other vehicle that I have that I could... I tried to get Accessibus to, you know... I had the rules changed. I had the government people, you know, that were elected go in and have certain regulations changed. And one of them was changed. Accessibus had to be changed to a 24-hour format instead of 8 days. And that was made law. That was made the rules. And when I called them up, they said, well, you know, we don't know. We can't guarantee we're going to pick you up. And you need to call us in eight days or seven. I said, that's not true anymore. And they argued with me on the phone and told me, yes. I said, no, it's not. It was changed to 24 hours. And they're still not doing it, even though it was changed. And I'm the one that had that law changed. I mean, you know what? Think about it. I've done everything civilized. I wrote reports. I did all kinds of stuff. I talked to government people. They had legislation change. People, and you know what? Holy geez, man. People want to point the finger at me like I've got a bad attitude. Holy, did you go through the 5 years that I've gone through trying to get someone to treat me with respect like I'd treat them? So now I told these guys, everyone, every time I've got a problem on Accessibus, on Metro Transit, I have to turn on my camera. I have to. And people all over the world are looking at my videos and they're saying, what? It's bad. It's really, really bad. You know, I don't want to bring a bad mark on Halifax, but my videos reach a lot of people and it's not me doing it. Like that guy there. He's right on camera. I hadn't even got around the corner yet, and I wasn't going to keep moving forward until I knew that the people would be out of the way because I couldn't spin around. There was no room. Impossible.
Right.
And he didn't lift the seat for me, and I hit the seat with my leg, so I had to stop and go back. Because when he was standing too close to me, I couldn't move forward so I can make the turn. So when I made the turn, I was up against the wheel well where the seat is, and I couldn't make the turn.
Okay.
Because he was too close. He would move out. That's what he did to me. He did it on purpose.
We don't know if he did it on purpose.
Oh, I have it on camera. You'll see it clearly on my video. I have it. He absolutely refused to be cooperative. He was mouthy to me, and I had enough of that.
But right then, at that point, with you still on the bus, you should have asked him to contact a supervisor to come.
You should have seen how bad is that. No.
Well,
this guy was nasty.
But the end of this would have been, we would have spoken to the operator. The operator would have been disciplined. And you would have been already on your way home.
No, I was stuck on that. I was already on the bus, stuck in the corner. And I when
right,
I
but we would have the two of us.
No. I didn't want to be there. I didn't want to be there with this guy on that bus with that attitude that he had. I don't like people like him. They scare me.
Okay, and I understand that. But what you got to realize now is the predicament that we're in. Is the buses that are running right now on the Route 61 of the new?
Oh, that wasn't the 61 that stopped.
No, that was 1066. That was a bus that could have took you home, but you.
No. The one that was here was not. It was not a 61. It couldn't take me home. It wasn't a 61. It was a 58 or 59 like that. It wasn't 61.
Oh, the
yeah, the one with the guy that caused me all the trouble.
The 68. Okay.
The very first bus was a 61, but it had no tie downs, and I can't do it.
Okay.
This chair here, right? It's got suspension on it because of my broken back.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be secured. The secure points are below the suspension. They hold the chair from this
yeah.
chair rocks
yeah.
Yeah. with like nothing. So right. if I'm in a moving vehicle and he puts the brakes on or turn, right. that chair is gonna fly.
Okay.
It's too heavy. I can't
okay.
do it, and not in my condition. Oh no. I want to try to live a few more years, and I don't want to have the doctors know that if my spine takes a bad jolt, I could be paralyzed anytime. My T8 is never heard of, and it's never happened. My T8 is crushed by 90%. I'm completely in two pieces. When I stand, it wobbles, right? So believe me, when I'm in my home walking around, I drag my feet, and I'm like an old man. And I used to be really fit and strong,
right.
And it's really depressing to have your whole life thrown away. I have no social life anymore at all. None.
Here's where we're at.
Towsy.
Towsy? Oh, yeah. Sorry.
That's all right.
Here's where we're at. I just got a phone Pat Moore. Okay? 1168 is coming. There's no way we can get that changed off.
So it doesn't have any tie downs?
No.
I can't go on that bus.
Okay. That's the bus that we have coming. So.
I gotta light this cigarette. I don't want to blow in your face, so just warning you. But.
So basically, that's your option. Otherwise, he said you may have to call a taxi.
You know what? It's not an option. I can't fit on taxis. My wheelchair does not fit. All the taxis that they license for wheelchairs are for manual wheelchairs that are tiny, small wheelchairs. Because if I try to get on one of those, the roof is right here across my head. That's how big my wheelchair is.
That's our only option right now.
Right, that's why I said I'm going to park in the middle of the street and call the police and cause a scene. I've got a, you know something? I'll just show you something, okay? Right here, I have a really loud speaker. It's a lot louder than that. If I park over there, I used to live in that building right there, and a lot of people know me in that building. I used to live right there in that building. I had to move to Halifax because I couldn't travel on buses around here. I had to give up my neighborhood where all my friends are because Metro Transit refused to provide me the service that's guaranteed by law. If I go park in the middle of that street, even the cops told me they can't put my boom boom chair. They don't have any means to, I don't even fit in their vehicles. So all you're doing is endangering my life. That's
but
all.
We have a vehicle here.
Tim, just a second. I'm not.
No, the one coming doesn't have any tie downs.
Listen.
She just told me that.
I'm not endangering your life.
My Metro Transit is.
That would be your choice to go.
That's
sit
not
in the
a choice.
It would be your choice to go sit in the middle of the road. That would be.
Oh
your
yeah.
Choice. Okay, that wouldn't be my choice. That would be a choice you'd be making.
Well, yeah, I got to do something.
So that's on you, not me. Right now, I'm just giving you what options that we have here at whatever time of night we're at.
Just after 10.
After 10?
Yeah.
And those are, unfortunately, that's the options that we have for the 6114. If you were just going somewhere like the bridge, or if you were going Scotia Square, it wouldn't be as big a deal because we've got numerous buses.
Even if I get to the bridge, at the bridge, I still need the 61 to get me home.
I know.
So
that's why I'm saying,
moving from here to there to catch the same bus, it makes no difference. There's no need to do that.
That's why I'm saying.
And you know, they just had shootings and stabbings and stuff at that thing there. That's not safe, that terminal. Even the bus driver got beat up the other day, right? Why would I want to park there in a wheelchair with all these stupid drunks and drug addicts? There's more people over there than here. That's more dangerous for me there at nighttime. That's why I wouldn't have had to get off the bus at the terminal. I'm not stupid. I know this neighborhood. I lived in this town.
That, unfortunately, I'm going to call him back. That's our options right now, and that's what I was told to tell you. So, unfortunately, if you're not willing to get on 1168...
You know what? I have enough power, okay, to get all the way down to the highway. I'm going to make a scene if you guys don't get me home.
It's not that we're not...
Well, I have to get home. You're not providing me any way to get home.
You're looking for this... We can't... We have these buses. These buses.
You have all kinds of old fire buses in this town. You've got all kinds of drivers.
Right.
You've got access to bus that you can call somebody, and you're not providing. You know what? By law, you have to provide this service.
We're doing everything that we
but
can.
But you're not providing me with a bus that
sure.
can secure my chair.
What you have to realize is we're talking to our supervisors. We can't do anything out of the ordinary, or it's on us. Okay? So we need to check with them first before we can do anything.
What's the name of the supervisor you're talking to?
That's Pat Meyer.
Pat Meyer, all right.
Yeah. That's our supervisor. That's who we're taking our orders from right now.
So Pat Meyer knows that that I can't travel on these new buses, and he knows that I'm stranded here, and he knows what's going on.
So you're saying you can't travel on these new buses?
Well, my camera's recording it, so I'm going to continue it. There's the bus that I'm supposed to be on. That's a 61. It's a new bus, and it doesn't have any tie-downs to hold my wheelchair. And Metro Transit is refusing to do anything to help me. They're refusing to provide buses that can hold my wheelchair down so that the wheelchair doesn't move around and kill me. So now, it's late at night. It's now 10:30, and I'm going to go up to a place up here on Portland Street that's open 24 hours, and I'm going to sit out there by the place, and I'm going to start talking to people and telling them what kind of trouble I'm in, and I'm going to tell them why that's happening. So this is the life that I have to live, and this is what happens in Halifax. The people here... or either don't care or just aptly stupid. But Metro Transit is very aware of what the problem is. 600 to 800 pound wheelchair with casters on it has to be secured. And they all wheelchairs have four tie downs that are welded onto the frame
so the wheelchair doesn't move around in a moving vehicle. They're called transport hooks. And the wheelchair has to be secured by those hooks, those transport hooks. Anyway, I'm going to get off this thing here, and I'm going to drive my wheelchair out before my power runs out. And I'm going to go somewhere where I'm a little bit safer with these people around. Thank you for watching. So to give you maybe the final report, no, it won't be, but this is now I've been at McDonald's. It's now like almost midnight. And I've been in there for a while, and the manager, I called up somebody, and they said they're going to send Metro Transit, Halifax Metro Transit is going to send Accessibus to come and get me. But when I called Accessibus, I got a recording saying it was closed. So because these people got involved, they're supposedly someone's going to come and get me home. But when I tried to do it, they wouldn't do it. Because I think what's happening with me is deliberate, because with cell phones, they can track you anywhere, and everything's computerized. And it's kind of funny that all the buses that came up when I wanted to go home were new. But all the other buses on this street, which was quite a few of them, were all the old ones that had the tie-downs for my wheelchair. So let's see how this turns out, because I'm sitting out here in the parking lot still trying to get home. So this is probably part number 8 now. So the bus comes, I try to get on the bus, and I have flags on the back of my chair that can fit through any door anywhere in the city. I never hit anything. But the bus here doesn't have a standard height door on it. The people, when they walk through that door, it's standard height, but that one isn't. So he's over here, so what are we gonna do? You gonna call, get him to bring an older bus over? Are you gonna get them to bring an old bus over? Who has to?
You do.
They did it, because when I call, I get a message saying that the office is closed. And what time is it closed? Pretty soon, right?
Yeah.
Anyway, thanks for trying, man.
Okay,
have a good night. So now I try to get back into McDonald's so I can get those people in there to call Accessibus before it closes, so they can send an older bus that has a higher roof, because that bus tore my flag and I was ripping the vinyl roof on that thing. I come over here, these kids are here, they get off their bikes and they leave them sitting right in the entrance in the way, so I can't get in here. And if I can't get in there to call these guys to come and pick me up really soon, I'm not going to get home at all. And these bicycles need to be moved, and they won't move them. So it's now almost 1 o'clock in the morning, and I was in McDonald's. And I decided to come out because I talk very loud and I love talking to people about things. And so I told the people inside, I'm going to go outside because I don't want to disturb you guys. The Accessibus that came, the roof was too low and I was tearing the roof apart. So now Accessibus and the service is not running. This police officer is going to go to my home and get the charger. And I'm going to sit out here for about 3 hours charging my wheelchair up. And I should be able to ride my wheelchair all the way home once I get a 3-hour charge. So this is where I'm at. I never got home with the buses. So now I'm at the Petro-Canada. The police officer went to my home and got me my battery charger. And we're trying to get me plugged in here for about 3 hours so I can ride my wheelchair home. But the plugs aren't working at this Petro-Canada. So there's another update for you. It's now 20 to 2 in the morning. Interesting, eh? Thank you for listening. Keep going. I'm going to give you more reports. Well, it's now 3:30 in the morning, and I'm sitting here at a gas station gassing up my wheelchair. Kind of funny, but there's the charger, and there's where I'm at. So, for those of you who don't believe me, that I would get stranded because Metro Transit refuses to provide buses that can safely transport my wheelchair. And that charger there, the green light's supposed to be on, and it's not, and I don't know why. But I'm going to turn on my chair and show you. Let's see, can you see this? There you go. So according to that, my chair is charging, but according to the charger, it's not charging. So I'm sitting here and I have to sit for another hour and a half minimum, because I'm in the city of Dartmouth right now. And I'm quite a ways from my home because I live in Halifax. So I'm going to have to drive this wheelchair in the dark. Luckily, I have auxiliary lights that don't hook up to my batteries. And I'm going to have to drive for about 45 minutes, hoping that this 3-hour charge is going to get me home. And I have to go probably, I would think, about 10 miles. Quite a distance. And I have to go all the way through the city, take a bunch of shortcuts everywhere. I have to go all the way across the McDonald Bridge, which is over the Halifax Harbor, and keep going, and quite a ways, and then I have to go to the downtown near the Halifax Commons where I live. So this is going to be pretty interesting whether or not I'm going to get home or not, because I don't even know if the chair for sure is charging or not. So I'm going to be splicing all these videos together so you people can see what I'm going through. But that incident that happened with that bus driver shows that there's something wrong with Metro Transit, because there's a conspiracy going on for sure, because he didn't know me, I hadn't said anything to him, and I got on the bus and his attitude started immediately. But the technology today is instant. People can communicate instantly. Metro Transit has cameras on all their buses. And I'm really wondering, because this is a major street here and there's no traffic right now. This is Portland Street. And I'm really wondering what happened tonight, because there's a lot of bus routes on this thing, but there's only one bus that can take me close to my home. And, you know, it's really weird because the 61 bus usually is the older buses that has the straps for securing wheelchairs. And it's not difficult for these guys to drive down the road and change their sign on their bus, as they're told, like when they come close to me. So every time a bus pulled up, it was a new one. And there was no tie-downs and I couldn't get on the bus. And the whole series of videos you've seen tonight shows the nightmare that I've gone through. And you heard the guys from Metro Transit, the inspectors, admitting that they were supposed to retrofit the buses. And that order actually went out in January. So they actually acknowledged that the buses cannot transport, the new ones cannot transport my wheelchair. But the end result is this, is that, a lot of things happened tonight. That piece about Accessibus coming over, the guy didn't help me to back up my wheelchair, didn't guide me. And I asked him, am I too far to the left? He said, oh, it's okay. And then when you lift up the ramp, I tried to back up and I couldn't, because the left side of my wheelchair was up against the railing. And so they had to drop the ramp back down. I had to try to maneuver my wheelchair over on the ramp. So we do it a second time. It doesn't really give me instructions. The Accessibus driver, it's kind of funny, because I'll tell you, the conspirators behind this are really good. They talk to people and coach them and tell them stories, whatever, about me. But that Accessibus driver wasn't helpful at all. And he knows how to do his job. He knows how to stand in front of me and center the wheelchair so he can tell me left, right. Didn't do any of that. And when I was backing up the second time to get into the bus, because I have to back in, I've got flags, as I mentioned, on my wheelchair. And the flags on the right is a carbon fiber, and it bends a bit. But the roof was too low, and it's a padded roof with vinyl or whatever. So when people get in and out, they don't bang their heads. But my flags were going to tear a hole through the roof. So I stopped my chair when I heard a noise. And I looked at the driver and wondering why he didn't notice that my flags were too high, because that's his job, you know. And wheelchairs that have flags on them, and everybody that goes out in wheelchairs has to have flags if you want to be safe trying to drive around in the city. So anyway, you know, one of my flags got bent, and the other one, the police took it off for me. But the driver of Accessibus didn't make any effort to remedy the problem and remove my flags, which is what he's supposed to do. He didn't offer, he didn't attempt. So when he lowered the ramp back down and put it on the ground, I asked him, what are we going to do? And he wasn't answering my questions. Are you going to call someone else? He didn't really tell me anything. So I ended up being stranded here. All because the drivers have an attitude, or they were given an attitude by the dispatchers or whoever else, because the people at management and Metro Transit are the ones that have been causing me my nightmare for a very, very long time. But anyone who's done any research about what goes on in the world, you realize that our governments have been taken over by corporate criminals. And those corporate criminals have taken all the important positions so that they can steer and control whatever they want. And if it happens to be an activist like me that's pretty well known, well, they've done everything they can to sabotage my wheelchair. Right now, I'm denied medical care. I'm denied any mechanics to work on my wheelchair. And my wheelchair has got some really serious driving problems, because the controller has been sabotaged. The right motor doesn't work properly, and it's causing my chair to shake and vibrate when I'm driving it, which causes me a lot of pain. And my right tire is already bald, and I just replaced it recently. So these guys here will not give me any services for my wheelchair. Accessibus has been denying me service now for several years, so this is the first time I even tried to get on Accessibus in 3 years. And there's so many crimes being committed against me in this town by certain people in higher positions. And it's been going on for so long, I just cannot believe, with all the effort that I've done and all the reports that I've written and the stuff on my websites that that nobody has done anything to help me out. It's really amazing. I don't know what they say about me behind the scenes, but I can imagine that the uninformed are probably thinking that I'm a crazy conspiracy theorist. And actually, I don't theorize on anything. If you go to atruthsoldier.com or any of my other websites and you do your own thinking, you'll realize that the information that's on there is from all the most intelligent people on the planet. And the only people that are intelligent are people that seek and speak truth. Because anyone that doesn't do that can't be very intelligent. So believe me, I'm not stupid, and I don't exaggerate, I don't do anything. And all my efforts since I ran that election in Toronto in 1984 has been only to wake people up, make them realize, you know, exactly what's been happening to our country. Canada's a commonwealth, and now we've been corporatized, and the corporate criminals are the ones that cause all the problems all over the planet with their mega corporations and everything else, because they produce money out of thin air on a computer screen with no accountability to anyone, because we have no governments anymore because they corporatize our governments. If you go to CanadianSituations.wordpress.com, you can find out about the post I just put there proving that Canada is a registered corporation on the U.S. Stock Exchange. I thought it was the New York Stock Exchange, but it's actually the U.S. Stock Exchange. So anyway, this is the life of being an activist in a country that once was free. And the insanity that's taken over this planet is worldwide, and that's all because a really gross group of people that like to hide in dark places have taken control of the creation of money. And everyone's got to wake up on this planet and realize that's our problem. And we've got to start having common sense come back, as Canada is a commonwealth country that was born on common sense. And, you know, I mean, me, I'm old, my health is really bad. I've been wounded really, really badly the last time they tried to kill me by driving that car over me repeatedly. And, you know, this idea that people in government are smarter or better than the rest of us, and that they have the right to hide behind secrecy. Secrecy is what's killing our society, because with secrecy means you have no truth. And our society belongs to all of us. This world belongs to everyone that lives here, but the land, it doesn't belong to anybody. We are only using it temporarily to live, but we're not, shouldn't be destroying the oceans and, you know, chemtrailing the skies. And I mean, holy geez, man, when I go on the internet, when I get home and I start getting my reports that I look at from all over the world, wow, the insane really are killing this planet. And there's only one thing that's going to save this planet, and that's a worldwide awakening, which is called a worldwide truth revolution. Not guns, not anger, not anything, just truth. And you start telling truth to everyone, the kids, the teachers, the, you know, the cops, the military, and if everybody in the world does their responsibility and realize that they're just as important as anyone else and we're all equals, you're either helping this planet or you're the one that's causing the harm. So you decide where you want to be, because this planet is dying. And the people that are living the good life off the credit system with their nice cars and their nice homes and everything else, well, that nice free ride you've been on for so long at the expense of everyone else that's suffering and starving and dying all over the planet, that the inequality, that the corporatization of our banks and our governments has created, has to be dismantled, or the planet is gonna die. If humanity's not guided into the future by truth, we're all doomed. Because the tree of life has to be planted from the seeds of truth, so that it can provide healthy food for thought for future generations, so that humanity can be rooted in a good, healthy roots that are of a healthy tree of life. Are you gonna be part of the solution? It's very easy. Stop lying to yourself and everyone else. Start loving and caring and speaking truth, because the minute you start speaking truth and you meet other people that speak truth, you realize that truth and love are one and the same. If you don't love this planet and you don't love every living creature and respect this planet, then you are the disease. So you pick and choose what you want to do. I made my decision when I was very young, living in that residential school somewhere near Montreal, watching all the horrors around me and all the little kids being beaten every day, and a lot of them got killed. And I went through a lot of horrors that I don't speak about. And I realized when I was very young that there's a big problem in this world, is that the pyramid scheme that the society runs under has got this illusion that somehow authorities and people higher than you are better than you and they know better. And, you know, you got to stop thinking that you live in a pyramid scheme and never realize we're all equals, because there's nobody above you. that's any different than you or any better than you. Just because they got a big car or a business or money doesn't make them any smarter or any better. The only way to judge a person is whether or not they speak truth or not. And I didn't say that truth. There's a big difference between that truth and truth. If you speak truth, that means you're always seeking and speaking it. If you say that truth, that's only like a photograph, a moment in time. And remember that truth is an action. If you, the second you don't seek it and speak it, it no longer exists. Because truth is constantly changing, and you have to be, you know, in understanding how to use your mind. Understand the meaning of the word truth and be a truther, which is what I am. And that's what Jesus was. And the only people that are going to save this planet are the truthers. But technology is so advanced today, and you know, they got all these weapons and all this insane. Now they got the Ukraine that they're destroying and bombing. They're bombing Syria. They're bombing Iraq. There's a world war on, guys. The Third World War has started, but the Russians made it clear recently that they're talking about the Fourth World War, which is going to be nuclear, which is about to happen. So we're already in the Third World War. There's already countries all over the place being destroyed. Yugoslavia, Libya. There's all kinds of atrocities happening all over Africa. And all this insanity that's all over the planet has all been fueled by our fake money that's produced on a computer screen. That's the real problem in this world. And you know what? Even if they kill me, it doesn't matter, because my information that I've published on the World Wide Web of freedom is spreading and spreading, because that's what you need to do. When you hear some truth, spread the truth, man. Spread those seeds of truth and start planting ideas and thoughts about freedom to other people and try to save this planet, because you know what? My life, I've sacrificed it for protecting our planet. I guess part of me, because I'm Métis, and the native part of me realizes that the only way to have a healthy mind is to have a healthy planet. And if we don't respect the natural world, then we're not respectable human beings, and we're killing the planet. It's pretty pitiful when I go home and I find out Fukushima is radiating the whole planet. The corrected stuff that BP sprayed into the oceans is still being sprayed, and that's killing the Atlantic. The Pacific is being killed by the radiation from Fukushima. And if you realize that the insane took over this planet, and that the insane have no self-control, and they also have no limits to their insanity, and they have no limit to the amount of money they have, and the control that that's given them over everybody else's lives, you might just begin to understand that maybe there's some truth about 9/11 and all the other stuff they've been doing. Do you understand what I'm telling you? There's an insanity that has taken over this planet, and everyone's conscience has been bought by fake money. The world is really, really a huge mess. But Canada and the USA are going in for the big fall, because we were set up for it. Agenda 21, the UN, North American Union, all that stuff. But right now, China, Russia, and all the countries of the world are dumping the American currency, which means that the North American economy is going to collapse. And there's going to be a lot of problems coming really soon. That can be changed right now if you, for once in your life, go out and respect truthers and become a truther and spread the seeds of truth. And you go to atruthsoldier.com if you want a good head start on a big library of knowledge about all the lies and deceptions we've been fed all our lives. So anyway, that's a 15-minute little talk, because I'm bored and it's late. And it's around 3:45 right now in the morning. So I will do another report later on when I take off and see if I can get home. And hope that nobody's going to attack me on my way home, because being out here in the middle of the night in the dark like this is absolutely dangerous for me. Have a good night. This is a true soldier speaking. Daniel Jude Towsey. Bye. So it's almost 5 o'clock in the morning, and the traffic is going to pick up pretty soon. I just unplugged my chair, and I'm going to try to make my trip home. And the daylight's going to start showing up, and now the fog came in. So the fog makes it a lot colder, and I don't know if I got enough power to drive this wheelchair all the way from the city of Dartmouth to downtown Halifax, across the bridge and everything. So if I think I won't have enough power, I'm going to go down to the ferry terminal and sit there until the ferry opens up around 6 in the morning. And take the ferry across to Halifax, which will save me some mileage. So you're just getting a little report now showing you what it's like to live in Halifax, where society doesn't really care, or the people that work for society really don't care about society. Because this nightmare of not being able to get around on buses is really terrible. And I guess I'm a pioneer because I'm the only one that's succeeding in living on his own and having to use an electric wheelchair to get around. Because everyone else that I know that's disabled ends up giving in to the system. And the system wants you institutionalized so they can make more money off of you and run and control your whole life. But me, that's not going to happen. I've been an activist and a freedom fighter all my life. And until I die, that's not going to change. So that's my report. There's the highway. You can see how rude it is. There's still no cars on the road. Stay tuned for more reports. It's all going to be done today. Well, it's now 5:30 in the morning. I'm sitting at the ferry terminal in Dartmouth, and it's as foggy as can be. And I found a place to plug this charger in. So I am charging my wheelchair again. I decided not to go across the bridge because I don't think I had enough battery power to do it. But this is what it looks like early in the morning on a foggy day on the Dartmouth waterfront. I'm still a long ways from home. It's going to be light out soon, and people are going to start coming to the ferry terminal to get to work. So it's like really early in the morning. I believe this is not Wednesday morning. So what a horrible night this has been for me. Not being able to get home on the buses because they can't secure my wheelchair. Thank you for watching. This is only a short little video because I'm going to put my camera away. It's really foggy. My camera's really wet. Goodbye. Stay tuned for more reports. Time to do another short little report to show you that it's that time in the morning. It's now 5:45. Can you believe that? I left just up the road at 8:30 last night. I wanted to head home. It is now almost 6 in the morning and I'm still out here and never got home because Metro Transit did this to me. And they have some of their drivers that are psychos or agents or whatever the hell they are, like that driver that refused to move out of my way, and it just I turned my camera on and I realized, oh, here we go again. So I wonder if I got set up last night where they just changed the numbers on the buses to make sure that none of the buses that could drive me home had 61 written on it. And what's really amazing is the crazy people that have taken over our governments have taken over the minds of a lot of police officers, different people, or bus drivers, or whoever the heck. But I tell you what happened last night is it doesn't make sense that the only buses that were 61 were the new ones, and all the other old buses flying by me, all of them were not new buses, and they had the proper tie downs for me to get home. So the one bus that I needed on all those buses out on that route, which is like 10 different buses. So why is it, I don't know what that noise was. Why is it that only my bus had no way to get me home? Anyway, that's another report. It's going on 6:00 in the morning. And I'll give you another report later. So here's another update. It is now 6:25 in the morning, and I am sitting waiting to get on that ferry that's going to pull out in about 5 minutes. And I'll do more reports until I get home. I am really tired. Driving a wheelchair when you're this tired is really dangerous. Imagine that, taking me 11 hours to get home because Metro Transit doesn't have any tie downs on their buses, and they left me stranded all night long on a city street in the dark. That is so criminal what they've done to me. And it's a good thing I have my camera with me to document all of this. 6:35 a.m. and I left Maynard Lake at 8:30 p.m. and by the time I get home it's going to be 7:30. So this is what happens when you leave somebody stranded that has to get around in a wheelchair almost 12 hours before I even get home. Shame on all you criminals in the government. It's now 6:40. And I'm just leaving the Halifax ferry terminal, downtown Halifax, and it's, as you can see, it's much lighter out now. So there it is. So there's my proof. So this is just another little piece that I'm adding to my Metro Transit, Halifax Metro Transit nightmare.